Earth First is not an organization. It doesn't have a president, vice president, or even a secretary. It doesn't have any officers at all. And no headquarters, no hindquarters. Who's their leader? They don't have a leader. They're all leaders. And there's thousands of them running around loose in these United States this very minute. Earth First got itself started about 7 years ago by a few people who were tired of all the compromising by the mainline environmental outfits. Earth First is against that kind of compromise. The way they see it, the wilderness is our natural native home. And when government and big business invade your home, you don't compromise, you resist. If political means don't work, try public protest. If that doesn't work, try civil disobedience. And if that doesn't work, as a last resort, you can try environmental sabotage. Earth First people call this monkey wrenching. Throwing a monkey wrench into the gears of the industrial system when it comes busting through the front door of your native original home. If I had a little more nerve, I might join up with them myself, at least at nighttime, and if I could get my mother and daddy to come with me.
Yeah, I'm here spiking this tree and all these other big ones around here today. They're planning to be cut by the Forest Service, and salesmen appealed. And there's basically nothing else that can be done, you know, nothing legal that can be done. It's the last method to save all these big trees around here. And we're putting the nails in. We'll be telling the Forest Service about it by an anonymous letter.
We are a very specific warrior society.
That's right.
And women trying to destroy everything that's beautiful, everything that's right, everything that's wild on this planet. And out of this planet, out of the earth, has emerged a society of warriors, women and men. We're planting their spears in the ground and are taking a stand. And that's Earth First.
Earth First, I think, is a radical environmentalist, eco-terrorist organization. Well, it's not even an organization. I think it's a loosely knit group of zealots who are, you know, personally motivated to go out and defend the earth using pretty illegal, pretty harmful, physically harmful tactics.
I've done all kinds of monkey wrenching.
Such as?
I've munched roads, I've spiked trees, I've siltated equipment. I don't know, I've burned their books.
A couple of us cut down a billboard last summer in Corvallis, got caught for that, fortunately. But done some other things here and there.
I am a criminal because I've broken what are considered the, you know, the laws that the society has set, so within that context I'm a criminal. But on the other hand, that doesn't have any negative connotations to me because I don't recognize those laws as being anything important anyway.
Ed Abbey said at the Little Granite Creek Ground River Rendezvous a few years ago, you shouldn't commit illegal acts except perhaps at night and with your parents' permission.
But 10 years ago, I was the chief lobbyist for the Wilderness Society in Washington, D.C. I began to feel, along with other people, that the environmental movement was steadily losing its passion and its soul. There were basically two things going on. One, that people working for environmental groups who'd started out as volunteers, impassioned amateurs, were becoming professionals and were becoming more concerned with careers, with salaries, with status, with access to high places, for the intrinsic value of access to high places. And while that was going on, we were asking for less. We were taking weaker stands on position.
Earth First is warriors. And if you aren't a warrior, then I suggest you find another group. And I'm not criticizing you, because there's a need for other groups and other methods. But in Earth First, we have got to be warriors first and foremost.
What I think about Earth First is they serve a purpose. They serve a purpose of moving the debate the next step. When you have corporations that act illegally and immorally, and when you have bureaucratic environmental organizations like the Sierra Club and the Wilderness Sign and the Audubon that move slowly, sometimes you need people who are so frustrated and angry that they take direct action. And I understand that type of behavior, and I understand the purpose that Earth First serves.
Well, basically, I think there are folks who have a definite opinion about how some of the natural resources of this country ought to be managed, and are willing to use any method available to them to express their concerns.
They're a radical environmental group that will not stop at anything to pursue what they feel is right.
I think what Earth First does is cross the line between peaceful assembly and peaceful demonstrations to things that really have an impact.
We feel that there's very little wilderness left, and very little of that is old growth timber, and some of this timber around here is the finest in the world, and we feel it's worth protecting.
Even worth going to jail for?
Yes.
I think Earth First is one of the most law and order organizations in North America. We want to have the laws enforced which protect habitat, which protect wild species, which protect wilderness, which protect national parks, which protect the riparian habitat and forested areas on private lands, and the administration is not protecting them.
I'm sure, based on their book, for instance, that they do not intend to hurt anybody. But they are definitely taking actions which have and can result in injury to people, and possibly even worse.
Sabotage is done because of a sense that there is a higher purpose than the existing laws. It's shocking, a shocking book. It scares me in a way. You know why it scares me? What? It scares me because there's the potential for violence and harm to human beings, and I have a problem with that. I don't want to see old growth forest ripped down, and I don't want to see people poisoned, and I don't want to see the air polluted, but I don't want to see anybody die either. I really don't.
I'm against the techniques and tactics that they prescribe in there. I'm much more given to let's get differences of opinions on the table and discuss them and see if we can work them out. Now, I'm sure that they come from the viewpoint that they've tried that and it hasn't worked, and so they have to take the next, what they consider the next step. And that is a step that I don't agree with.
Showing how to spike roads, to spike trees, to dismantle helicopters, to destroy tractors, it's terrorist activities.
Sometime when you have immoral timber and corporations and you have illegal oil industry folks doing the things they're doing, you have to use their kind of tactics. And their kind of tactics sometimes end up, unfortunately, at this level.
Well, I have some complaints about the book, Ego Defense.
Let's hear it.
Well, there's this section on adding sand or sediments and things to the oil casings. It doesn't say how much. Do I add a little thimble full or Earth 5 pounds? I could spend all night finding the right amount of stuff to put in there and worry about them coming and getting my friends arrested or something.
Yo! Whoa. Yo!
Turn it off.
Earth First offered something that other environmental groups hadn't. I had been an environmental activist for about 8-10 years. And I was doing everything. I was writing letters, I was talking to my congressman, I was, you know, reading environmental impact statements, I was leading hikes to introduce people to the woods, and I was losing. And being reasonable just didn't seem to be getting anywhere. Playing the game, playing the system just wasn't working. The trees were still being cut, the rivers were still being dammed, the air was dirty, the water was undrinkable. And then I met Earth First.
My first exposure to mainstream environmentalism was a slideshow at Punch and Cookies. And I didn't feel like those people were leaving that meeting with any type of energy to go out and work by themselves, do something on their own as an individual to further the cause. Rather, they were being fed and then going home and sated, didn't do anything else. And I feel like what we do as Earth Firsters or as direct action environmentalists is inspire individuals to continue the work that they've been exposed to on their own.
I have no choice but to do this. I don't know. It's just somehow the rainforest speaks to me, the wolf speaks to me, the condor, you know, asks for my help, and I can't say no.
One of the things we said when we started Earth First was we'll let our actions set the finer points of our philosophy. That's one of my disagreements with the Greens, is that they seem content to sit around and hammer out these detailed agendas and statements of principles and all of this, and then never do anything about it. Earth First is the only activist green group around, if you want to look at it that way. The others are debating societies.
Action! Action of any kind! And let our action set the finer points of our philosophy. We don't have to figure it all out. We don't all have to be pure. We all don't have to be saints on this planet to do something for it. We don't have to have our philosophy honed down to the nth degree. There's room for inconsistency. But do something!
Even if it breaks the law, there, I do believe in a higher law.
It's time for a warrior society to rise up out of the earth and put ourselves in front of the juggernaut of destruction, to be antibodies against the human pox that's ravaging this precious, beautiful planet. I don't want to live if there aren't any rhinoceroses. I don't want to live if there aren't any mountain lions in California. That's what my life is for. It's to throw it in the wheels of this insane progress and to fight for it.
Yes!
That's what warriors are for. That's what a warrior society is for.
Monkey wrenching is a tool. This tie is a tool. You know, I go and I lobby members of Congress, and I go and I talk to, you know, the LA Times editorial board, and I go and I talk to the ARCO Civic Action Breakfast League on, you know, how to do what we think we're doing. And they don't like listening to me unless I'm wearing a coat and a tie. But, you know, it's just a tool. And I think the tools that we need are the legislative process, the public relations process, the consciousness raising of the American public, and occasionally a tree spike to get our agenda across.
It's habitat and survival that count. Not the process. That's the difference between Earth First and the mainstream environmental movement.
What Earth First has done for us here is pretty much given, rallied the community in a positive way against the environmental community.
We realized that we had accomplished our first major goal when we started Earth First, which was a realignment and a restructuring of the environmental movement. And that is that the Sierra Club now is taking stronger positions. The California Desert Protection Act of Senator Cranston's is a good example. Several years ago, the Sierra Club only wanted 5 million acres. Then through Earth First influence, they thought, well, why shouldn't we ask for everything we want? And they moved it up to 8 million acres. In other words, Earth First is convincing good people and mainstream environmental groups not to compromise before the game starts.
I don't think Earth First has credibility with anybody, frankly. I think there's a few people on the radical fringe that think Earth First is credible, but the forest products industry doesn't think they're credible.
I don't care about credibility.
Okay, man.
I don't care if we're credible to William Penn Mott or to Jim McClure or to Donald Hodel or to F. Dale Robertson. Donald Hodel and F. Dale Robertson don't have any credibility with me. They're sick.
I don't believe the Forest Service thinks they're credible, and I don't think the public does. When you see Earth First members howling like wolves before the moon on local TV, it does nothing for their credibility.
As long as they're willing to work within the normal bounds of restraint, we're willing to listen to any dissent they have to present.
We aren't interested in credibility or legitimacy with a gang of thugs running this planet. We don't care if Senator James McClure or Secretary of the Interior Donald Hodel don't want to let us in their office, because they don't have credibility with us. They are just a bunch of back street alley thugs that have power and who are running things and who have no moral or ethical right to have any control over us.
Circling the universe, circling the universe,
on wings of pure light.
It makes us look moderate, you know, to be quite frank, it makes us look moderate. When Earth First is out there saying 100 million acres, and we know that we really only can get 25 million acres, and, you know, I go to Congress and I'm saying, you know, 25 million acres, and they're screaming 100 million, I can turn to the Congressman and say, we're the voice of reason, you know. It's frightening in the society to some politicians that the Sierra Club's the voice of reason.
Well, compared to Earth First, they're a lot more moderate, but I am worried about their quiet acceptance or their lack of condemnation of Earth First and terrorist activities.
Earth First was a fundamentalist revival, an attempt to get back to the roots of Muir Leopold Marshall, to say that wilderness has a right to exist for its own sake. Okay, now, this was a philosophy that a lot of people in the environmental movement believed in, but nobody was willing to articulate it publicly.
Long is the legend of the life of John Muir, and many are the dangers he braved. Without his leadership, you can be sure, Yosemite would never been saved. A century later, the battle remains. The momentum we're facing is huge. So is the movement inspired by his name, his courage and his work living. Your power to you, and you fight to keep that river alive. Your power to you, as you help another species survive. Your power to you, John Muir would have been proud.
Oh, I think John Muir would be proud of the Sierra Club. And I think John Muir, the principles that John Muir set down when he was trying to save Yosemite, the exact principles that we use now.
The worldview of the executive director of the Sierra Club is closer to the worldview of Jim Watt and Ronald Reagan than it is to that of Earth First.
And one reason why we see Sierra Club as being inadequate is that they are basically trying to reform a system which we feel is totally destructive of life, and we are trying to subvert the system
we'd like to see the system collapse. When I say the system, I mean the industrial, modern industrial system as we know it. And one reason why we see the modern industrial system as being so destructive is because it is based on the premise that human beings are superior, and that it is for human beings that the world exists. And I think that a lot of Sierra Clubbers accept that premise, whereas Earth Firsters reject that in favor of a biocentric worldview, the idea that human beings are just another species among millions of others on the planet.
The Sierra Club is part of the system to because we choose the system, the governmental system of to be a tool that we use. But are we accepted parts of the system by those who are in control? We're definitely not calling the shots.
Well, moderate environmentalism is bureaucratic in nature. The issue, the way I see it, is right here. That's the issue. The issue isn't sitting and cutting deals in smoke-filled rooms.
The mainstream groups, and a lot of times, aren't even saying what I'm saying. It's, you know, their positions are far too moderate. They're willing to give up too much to commercial interests.
The major environmental groups are still are reform. They still believe in the system. They still think that whatever man can use, that man's use of the natural world is still the highest and best purpose, and they're just arguing about whether backpacking is better than mining or not. And whereas I think that Earth First is saying that the natural world, for its own sake, for its own continuance, for its own continued life and diversity, is the highest and best use of this world.
They are anti-technology, they're anti-capitalism. I think they're more of a socialist or Marxist kind of philosophy, and they're digging at the basic roots of the United States and its Constitution. And I think they're a significant threat to the American way of life here.
It's not a problem with capitalism or anything like that that I'm talking about. It's sort of a problem with money in general. Money is a system that tends to canalize and sort of almost flow against the ecological energy flow in order to be part of a system which is making use of it, utilizing it.
We aren't left, we aren't right, we aren't in the middle, we aren't even in front or behind. We aren't even playing that game.
They're a loose-knit, I'd almost say disorganized, radical environmental group. They aren't an environmental group, maybe like the Wilderness Society or the Sierra Club, that stand up and fight issues at the level they should be fought.
Radical means coming from the root, one of the definitions. I think that certainly in that respect we're radical, that we go to the roots. John Muir, Aldo Leopold, Rachel Carson, it's the old time religion as far as we're concerned. But radical also means it's relative to what other people are advocating. So in that respect, you know, we can have a radical wilderness proposal. We can take radical means to achieve our ends. And so I think radical would be correct in that sense. But are we truly radical? You know, is what we're saying really extreme? I think not. That, you know, we're more conservative.
I consider myself a conservative.
That warrior spirit is too valuable to be wasted on wars. Let it be placed in a better context. For instance, acting to save our Mother Earth. Then the fire-fangled feathers really dangle. The bow burn gold, the spear shine in the sun.
I think we have to look at the real definition of the words we use nowadays. I mean, the corporations like to talk about extremism and radical behavior and all those type of things that they like to broad brush environmentalist with. And I think it's extreme to pollute the air. I think it's radical to cut down old growth forest. So if their actions escalate things to the point where the next action is the spiking of a tree, at that point nobody's hurt, nobody's injured, the tree isn't cut down, then the next action that has to be taken is they're going into the forest to clear cut or do what they're doing, and that's when the confrontation and the escalation gets to the point of possibly somebody getting hurt, possibly being illegal. I think the immoral action is based on the immoral activity of the corporation, not on the spiking of the tree.
And that is our political approach, is one of monkey wrenching, of thwarting it, a political aikido, of taking the energy of the mad machine and turning it against itself.
Really? Yeah.
Of taking the power of the iron ore and a bulldozer and liberating it so it can go back to the earth. Of taking the madness of the Forest Service's spore plan and twisting it against the Forest Service. Yeah, we file appeals and lawsuits. We write letters, make wilderness proposals. But we aren't fooled for a minute that we're engaged in liberal reform. We're sticking a wrench in the system. We're slowing it down. We're thwarting it. We're kicking it in the face.
We do get some concern when people do not use those channels which we provide and go to some other method which disrupts and in some cases endangers the safety of people while they're doing their jobs. Some other techniques which we have seen, which I think are prescribed in Dave's book, like removing all of the survey stakes on a road, for instance. Mm-hmm. Now that's very easy for someone to do, walk along a road survey line and remove all those stakes without thinking about how much it'll cost to replace those, sometimes $15,000-$20,000 worth of damage can be done in an afternoon.
The philosophy behind that is if enough of this goes on, if enough damage is done to the industrial tools of the incursion in the wild places, then insurance rates are going to go up. The Forest Service won't be able to both build new roads and keep their old network together if it's being torn up.
You can look at the economic aspect, long-term and short-term. It may cost a logging company so much that if all the trees are spiked and a couple of their machines are trashed, it may cost them so much that next month they can't afford to bid on another sale.
It has cost us some money, and not only from the forest products industry, the logger who's out there or the road builder who's out there trying to make a living or the mill operator that's relying on the timber supply from that sale.
So I calculate it probably caused about $1 million worth of damage recently, but they can sue me. I don't have any money. Ha, ha, ha. Go to jail, free coffee. Great, 3 meals a day. TV.
Monkey wrenching is, in many ways, is using the tools of the devil against the devil. And that's a very broad thing, a very broad definition, I think. But specifically, monkey wrenching can mean quasi-illegal acts. Of course, tree spiking is a favorite topic to discuss. But I think that any action that is a personal action and a commitment against, or some type of action against the juggernaut of industrial civilization is monkey wrenching, whether it's a tree spike or whether it's sand in a gas tank.
Well, one type of monkey wrenching is this destruction of private property, such as machinery, which is being used in a destructive fashion. Monkey wrenching, of course, also includes activities such as removing ribbons from trees that are to be cut, pulling up survey stakes. In short, I see monkey wrenching as direct action, which is generally illegal, with the goal of stopping wilderness destruction or some other type of environmental harm.
I'd say it was responsible action to decommission a selected target that is damaging some natural area.
What we're doing is
tearing off the clear cut tags and all the ribbons on this proposed clear cut unit. The Forest Service has plans to clear cut all this whole area. That's what the yellow tags and the flagging mean. They go all around here, it's about 30 acres. And they're tearing these off and hiding and burying them. Totally remove all trace of the survey.
Earth First, while we don't all engage in monkey wrenching, or even advocate it, is that we do not condemn it. We do not put it down. That we recognize monkey wrenching as a legitimate tool of self-defense for some people within Earth First.
Monkey wrenching is not guerrilla warfare, it's monkey warfare, that people could support it because it's not threatening, and that we have to employ it very carefully, very selectively.
I'd call it terrorism.
I think that people who say that have never spent a week in Beirut, or even say in Paris.
Terrorism, by definition, is the killing of, sort of the wanton killing of innocent civilians to achieve some sort of political goal, whereas ecotage definitely makes a big effort not to hurt living things at all, and is basically oriented, it's a defensive sort of thing. It's the idea is to stop a bulldozer that's bashing a road into the wilderness, to prevent loggers from cutting trees, things like that.
Terrorism is a violent attack that puts human life in jeopardy. Monkey wrenching is simply sabotage of inanimate machines for ecological purposes.
I don't know if it's terrorism or not. I couldn't tell you. It's certainly a violation of law, and I think a violation of proper behavior.
I'm sure it depends on each individual's perspective. To me, it's very close to terrorism.
Everybody follow the bouncing spike!
Been a tree spiker for many years. I spend all my money on tree spikes and beer. I go down to the valley where it's all timber grows.
One of the most bothersome things here is that our local Audubon and Sierra Club and even our local Earth First chapter have not come out and strongly condemned the activities of Earth First. You never heard anybody saying, well, gosh, it's really too bad that the mill worker down in Northern California had his face ripped up by a spike. And until people start saying, hey, we don't think it's worth human life to save these areas, they're in a sense condoning murder.
Logging companies won't want to bid on a sale like this, and they know the trees are full of nails. And we get them up high here so the actual loggers don't get hurt if they go to cut them, but they know the companies will know their blades will get damaged in the mill by these things if they do try to cut them, but like I said, we'll notify them. So they probably won't try. They probably won't even try.
Put a log on the carriage over here, and as that carriage comes forward on the left side of the band there, the teeth saw the log as the bandsaw is going around. What happened there is they hit a spike that was embedded in the wood, and the bandsaw actually broke in two pieces and flew out of there, and part of it hit this guy in the neck and knocked his teeth out and did quite a bit of damage. That's the reason that mill employees are a little bit concerned about tree spiking going on by environmental groups that are protesting the logging of these areas.
Monkey wrenching is a defensive action, and I think that it's aimed at guilty parties. The trees, for example, in tree spiking, a mill is a guilty party in the destruction of the forest.
Terrorism is destruction of biodiversity, the freedom of not only the natural life forms to live out their lives unfettered and free and alive, but to at the same time extinguish human spontaneity and human freedom. That's true terrorism. It's terrorism in the form of Western governments today.
That doesn't even bother me whether people call us terrorists, because I think
The most important thing, part of our work, is to get our message across. And those people who think we're terrorists are not damaging us, because we are still getting our message across to those who are sympathizers. And the more we the more sympathizers we reach, the stronger we become. And in the end, I think people will realize that the terrorists are really the people we have been fighting, the destroyers of the earth.
What happens in a clear cut is they destroy all the trees in the area, all the old growth trees, all the species that depend on old growth have no place to go. They disrupt the soil completely. The soil is completely disrupted, it's completely torn up, it's going to erode. What happens is that there's a net decrease in the amount of species in this area. The species that depend on old growth, like spotted owls, woodpeckers, have no place to go. This is done on a very large slope here. It's probably an illegal one, but no one watches it. It's going to go down, all this soil is going to erode down into the creek down there. If there's any trout breeding grounds down there, they'll probably be destroyed.
Clear cutting is where you harvest everything that's merchantable off a given, say you have 5 acres or 10 acres you're going to harvest. You cut everything, take it all to a landing and haul it to a mill, or use it somehow, firewood or whatever. And so there's nothing left. It's as bare as the mill yard here.
I pretty much feel that the biological and ecological foundation of the earth is under siege right now. And something has got to be done to at least slow the technological beast down to the point where we can stop and at least examine what we're doing.
We have essentially halted the process of speciation or evolution on this planet, and we've even succeeded in turning it backwards. And this is something that is accelerating at an alarming rate.
Some of the most respected and famous biologists and ecologists in the world today are saying things that make my blood run cold. That if I didn't get drunk now and then, if I didn't have a sense of humor, I'd strap dynamite around myself and go down Glen Canyon Dam. We are living in an era of overpowering horror. Michael Soule, founder of the Society of Conservation Biology, recently said that vertebrate evolution may be at an end. Others have said that 1/3 of all species may become extinct in 20 years. That by the turn of the century, the only large mammals left will be those we choose to allow to exist. Let that sink in, my God!
Better empty.
We don't have time for normal life.
Oh!
We don't have time to pretend that it's business as usual.
Where the biggest mammals at? Where our future food is at? Keeps the atmosphere intact. The ocean is our habitat. We depend on your habitat. Have to have a habitat. You have to have a habitat to carry on. The forest is a habitat, a very special habitat. It's where the tallest trees are at.
Where a bear can scratch her back.
It keeps the ground from rolling back, renews the oxygen.
In fact,
the forest is a habitat. We depend on it. Have to have a habitat. Old growth spotted owl with us.
I don't think we're losing any species on a whole scale. I mean, I guess they're saying that just because we're logging these areas, we're going to lose all these species. Well, I say that's kind of a farce.
The exciting part is trying to figure out how we can have the grizzly bears and the pileated woodpeckers. Of course, we don't have grizzly bears here, but how you can have pileated woodpeckers and spotted owls and still maintain a healthy communities. Because if you don't have healthy communities, there's not going to be anybody there to appreciate those critters, the things that are available.
Given what has already happened in industrial society, we will be sitting with our own wastes. We will be sitting for hundreds and perhaps thousands of years with toxic wastes, with nuclear wastes, and that how we deal with that says something about how we are as persons.
Breathing may become hazardous to your health. Trespassers will be shot, sold, and subdivided. And your sister tortured with electricity. And the mushroom cloud red eye, like wine on our breath.
I think things are under control. It takes constant vigilance, and it takes everything from, you know, introducing legislation to an occasional tree spike, but things are under control.
Yeah, right now things are under control of corporate interests on the planet as a whole, and you know, they don't seem to care much for anything except short-term profits and how much power they can create for themselves.
Even in terms of the management philosophies that they're currently using, that they're not, that agencies of the government, that reform environmental groups and corporations are not doing a very good job in our estimation.
People don't adopt industrial lifestyles. They have it shoved down their throat. And the only way to get rid of it is to cough it up, you know, and that's going to be a violent reaction.
All right, here's my notes. Why don't you stand by with these?
Probably not the right one.
We're talking about no compromise in remaining 10% of the continent that is being rapidly galloped up, because in the last 200 years so much of it has been used in this industrial juggernaut that keeps biting away at the lifeblood of the continent.
We are offering a fundamental challenge and critique of industrialism, progress, and technology. Are we Luddites? You're damn right we're Luddites! Yeah. Yeah. Do we love the sound of a burning bulldozer? We love the sound of a burning bulldozer!
No one stands up and questions technology or industrial society because they don't recognize the rights of other species to inhabit the earth. The only way you can have industrial society is to trample on other habitats, you know, other communities.
I don't think technology is going to kill us. I think a judicious use of technology and an intelligent use of technology is the answer. I don't believe in going back to a pre-industrial society as a solution to any problems.
Many of us in the deep ecology movement or the Earth First movement would like to see human beings live much more like the way they did 15,000 years ago, as opposed to what we see now.
So better beware, be wary, be warned, be aware that though the budgie chirps in her cage, gross national product, tweet, tweet, the fingers on the trigger, the teeth is in the neck, and old man coyote is a humpback groucho. Ow!
There is some things wrong with the industrial system when profit becomes greed and when greed becomes the driving principle. There's nothing wrong with the system of profits when it's balanced with some type of environmental sensitivity.
The major threat to biological diversity is industrial society. I mean, even though everybody has up applying technology, no whether if it's just simple agriculture or sophisticated hunting and gathering and herding as a lapse. You know, everyone has certainly made mistakes, but no one has made mistakes like we're currently making right now.
I think maybe Earth First would like to see, you know, cities ripped down and Los Angeles go back to the Indians, and I understand that that's not reality.
We're anti-technology. Somebody's got to be anti-technology.
What we're going to do here is the, in this area of Forest Service, the trees are going to save in this clear cut here, mark for the big W for wildlife. By just carefully marking a few extra, you know, these are trees that we save, and they'll never really know the difference. And it's a real good trick. You've got to use the same kind of paint. But as long as you don't mark too many, they'll never really know.
Earth First is just simply a warrior society that has a biocentric impetus. Our goal is to protect as much threatened natural diversity as is possible now, to save the building blocks, to make sure that there are grizzly bears and great blue whales and rainforests and old growth redwoods somewhere, so that in the final thrashing of the industrial monster, everything else that's good on this planet is not destroyed. That our job is damage control.
I think we've learned that because they threw the book at me, because I got a maximum jail sentence, that tells us something. That tells us that the developers, that the uranium miners here in Arizona, that the loggers in Montana, that the Forest Service across the country, that the politicians fear us, that they fear what we represent.
I see monkey ranching or sabotage as a very limited part, a small part of a much larger campaign.
It's not an end-all tactic, but during a campaign where we're trying to protect old growth, there can be some spiking, road desurveying, equipment being damaged as part of an overall attempt to slow down or in some cases even to harass the people who are involved in this, you know, this tremendously destructive activity. So.
Monkey wrenching is kind of almost a coup de grace and the most unexpected tactic that we have. And it's the one that costs the other side the most money and is hardest for them to defend against. And it absolutely is part of a vital strategy.
The future of monkey wrenching is that it's going to continue to become more and more widespread. More and more people are going to engage in it. Some people are going to get caught. That's inevitable. Some people are going to go to jail.
It's very clear that some of their actions are a crime, and they should be dealt with as criminals.
The only monkey wrenchers they've caught were caught because of their own foolishness, their own carelessness. The Forest Service in Oregon has turned over tree spiking cases to the FBI now because they've admitted that they can't do anything with it. Of course, the FBI can't do anything with it either.
Earth First members need to be held accountable for their actions, whether it's tree spiking or damaging equipment or causing loggers lost time.
There are already existing laws in the book in which Earth First strongly supports. And in a certain sense, strongly supporting those laws means that you have to engage in sabotage if you do support those existing laws on the books because the administration is not supporting them.
I think, on the other hand, when they go too far to endanger people's lives through maybe tree spiking or some other form of terrorist activity, I think they've gone too far.
Laws are forgotten, or the laws are avoided, or the laws are completely thrown away, and then you still have the old growth forest being cut down. I can see why people would then spike the trees and lay down in front of the bulldozers.
I'm saying take the law into your own hands. That's all you have to do. If you just go by their laws, down come the trees,
and then
up goes
one,
the slash
and this one. And Yeah, how are we going to do?
Why are we doing all of this? It's because we are the most important generation of human beings to ever walk this planet. That today, this moment, 1987, is the most critical time in 3.5 billion years of organic evolution on this planet. We aren't trying to save backpacking parks. We aren't trying to clean up the air so we have nice scenic views of the Grand Canyon. We're trying to help evolution continue. Yeah.
Whether it's nuclear war, Big Mountain, acid rain, all these are mere symptomatic ills of a basic divorce from our source, the sacred Mother Earth. By finding our place in the earth, we find out who we truly are.
We are the children of Turtle Island, a story that's old and that's new. On Turtle Island, there's a turtle smiling, carrying the world for you.
Oh my!
Carrying the world for you.
Wilderness. Wilderness is the essence of everything we're after. Natural diversity. We aren't an environmental group. Environmental groups worry about environmental health hazards to human beings. They worry about clean air and clean water for the benefit of people and ask us why we're so wrapped up in something as irrelevant and tangential as wilderness, something as elitist as wilderness. Well, I can tell you, Kaibab Squirrel doesn't think wilderness is elitist.
They don't have any compassion for people. They're out there trying to save the wilderness. And who are they trying to save it for? If it's not people, I don't know what they're trying to save it for.
Wilderness is the essence of everything. It's the real world. And our goal is the day when there is no word in any language on earth for the concept of wilderness. Because that concept is no longer needed. Because everything is wilderness. And it just is.
It's no longer a concern for the environment that motivates these people, that it's a social revolution that they're talking about.
As Muir, he said that if it comes to a war between the races, I'll side with the bears.
And what side would you be on?
And I say that time has arrived.
John Muir would say I would be on the side of the grizzly bear.
Depends. Certain bears, certain people. All bears and all people, I don't know.
The bears.
The problem with Earth First is that they don't care about people. They really don't care. They could care less. The people who came here to sit
down.
It depends where your priorities are. If you look at something like a 1,000-year-old tree or an irreplaceable old-growth ecosystem, it's a matter of priorities. Deep ecological philosophy holds that living things have a right to exist. Living individual trees, systems, ecosystems, whatever, have just as much as right to exist as individual humans or human societies.
Deep ecology is a philosophy that enunciates this the whole idea of biocentrism, that the natural world is greater than and more important than the small part of it that's the human race.
I think the principal tenet of deep ecology is the endorsement of biocentrism. All life is equal, or all natural life is equal.
I think it entails on how we experience the world. If we experience the world as an extension of ourself, of our ecological self, if we have a broader and deeper identification, then we feel hurt when other beings, including non-human beings, are harmed.
I think it offers people a way back from the alienation and pain that are pretty much the dominant themes of the modern age. People feel less and less connection to each other, obviously. Probably no connection whatsoever to the land anymore because it's such an abstract idea to them as they sit on their freeways and commute to work. And this offers, I think, a way back into the unity, a way back into the whole and into the scheme of things, kind of a spiritual completeness that we've been without for 7,000 years.
Look at the these ponderosa pines. Look at the maypole. They're screaming out with joy. And that's what we've got to scream out with, whether we're sitting in jail or standing in front of the bulldozers or writing letters or being crushed by the oppressiveness of urban smog. We've still got to ring with joy. And there is no more glorious life than the life of a warrior in defense of what's right.
Right on.
And my heart is so buoyed and so cheered by the warriors I see here this week. The women, the men, the children, those of us who are turning gray, we're all warriors. We're all fighters. We're all dedicated to something so much larger and greater and more beautiful than ourselves. And that's the essence, I think, of being a warrior. It's a recognition that in your life, the most important thing is not your life. As Martin Luther King said, the human being doesn't have something they're willing to die for. They don't deserve to live. Those are hard words, but they're true words. And I pity those people who are only interested in their paychecks and their VCRs and their own life. And I salute you. And I celebrate you. And I love you for being fellow warriors. Earth first!
We depend on your habitat.